Hi everyone, thanks for joining this session of the Azure APAC Infrastructure webinar series. My name is Arno, I'm a Cloud Security Officer in APAC, and I'll be your host today. I have the pleasure to be with Laurent. Hello Laurent.
Hello Arno.
Can you tell us a little bit more of your background and what you do at Microsoft currently?
Absolutely. So Arno, I've been with Microsoft for 3 years, and I've been working in the financial services sector, so helping large organizations like Tier 1 banks in the UK to adopt Azure. And I'm going to share with you my real world experience.
That's really what we want, to make it real, keep it real. So we're going to have a very short agenda here on governance versus agility. Do we have to choose? Can we have both? That's what we're going to try to see. Then we're going to discover a little bit of the Azure Enterprise adoption techniques, strategies, and framework. And then we're going to see what are the tools that are available really to make that governance happen, because we don't want it to be a theoretical model. We want really to enforce that and make it real. And then we'll finish up with not only the Microsoft tooling and toolset, but extending that to the ecosystem. And Terraform is, of course, one of the very big guys that we see on the market. So that's the plan for today. A couple of slides, a bunch of demo, half-half. Let's start with that. So really what we want to happen in the environment and in the governance of IT environment, we know this friction that exists, right, between the development or the business unit and the IT and the corporate governance environment. And basically one of the guys, and it's really what we want, you want to see fast innovation, you want to deploy new stuff, deploy cool stuff for your customer, for your internal customer or external customer. And at the same time, you have the governance, which says, well, you know what, maybe not, but well, does it fit with this framework? So finding a compromise, I think, in the real world is sometimes a little bit challenging, right?
Oh, absolutely, Arno. And I can really echo what you are saying. So large organizations really want to innovate. So they want to benefit from the cloud innovation. The business is pushing very hard, actually, to be able to deliver new value, new outcome to their end customers. And you can see the balance between the push from the business and also the IT. We want to keep governance, make sure that you can innovate, but not doing something that is not authorized by them.
Yeah, so what we believe is we don't have to choose speed versus control. It's really speed and control. And what we believe at Microsoft is really this security and compliance and governance is really an enabler of this fast innovation, but at the same time being compliant with all the regulation that financial sector have, industry and pharmaceutical have. So actually getting best of both worlds by providing you with the framework and the tool sets to implement that in the real world. And the real world is also about innovation, and what we want is to include that as soon as the development process, right?
Absolutely, absolutely, Arno. And I spend a lot of time actually with the developers and helping developers to learn how to build application, born in the cloud application. That's a terminology you will hear quite a lot. And it's very important to give to the developer as well early stage, early information about does it work in the framework, in the context that the organization has set. So for that, we've got some toolings with DevOps where we can also include in the pipeline different control and validation to help the developers understanding if what they are doing match the compliance.
So pretty much we want the compliance and the governance not being like bolted on at the end of the cycle, but doing through the whole cycle, include that all the way.
You want to inform the developers as quick as possible. So let's say, for example, you build a new feature and you want to release that in your dev environment or your test environment. You want to make sure that this feature is not going to break what has been agreed by the organization. So for that, in Azure DevOps, so you can integrate some validation with the policies and the security and the monitoring, and also make sure that you keep an evergreen. You will hear the term evergreen quite a lot in the digital transformation world. And by keeping evergreen, it's not just making sure that my features are working, but also my policy, my compliance, my control, all the security framework that you want to put in place are also green.
You mentioned that it's about developer, and basically now everything is code, right? We even have infra as code, so even when you're developing your IRM template for the deployment of your environment, it's including all of that in this cycle.
Absolutely. What you are describing here is software. So the beauty of the cloud, everything is becoming software. So when you want to deploy a virtual machine, when you want to deploy your network, whatever you do is software. So at some point, you will use an automation tool, and the idea is to be able to automate as much as possible in order to make sure that you can apply different quality gates in your process to confirm that the compliance has not been compromised.
Very well. So one of the framework for Azure Enterprise adoption is very well and thoroughly described in one white paper and series of white paper that you call Azure Virtual Data Center. I would strongly recommend you to get this time and this reading on aka.ms/VDC. And that's really a description of a set of building on Azure, building on all those environments that we've been building in order to recreate a data center virtualized, relying on all those technology and being relying on the identity layer as the ultimate basically control plane for your environment. Identity is the new control plane for anything security. Using and relying the high availability of the data center environment, the compliance framework, which is as we speak 88 compliant offering into different frameworks around the world, which are basically worldwide recognized, like ISO, CSA framework, SOC, or other thing more regional, like in Singapore, MTCS level 3 compliance, for instance. And it's leveraging on all those efforts, all this engineering that Microsoft did in order to create a virtual data center based on that. And everything being controlled by the software, as you mentioned, and everything building on that. So the architecture that we see on this slide and on the white paper, we're gonna discover a little bit about this later and rediscuss about this, what we call a hub and spoke topology. But before doing that, I propose, Laurent, that we probably get a little bit of a tour of all the elements that we have in terms of architecture, reference architecture, architecture center, and some of the compliance stuff that we were talking about.
Sure, let me show you.
To access the Azure portal, you need to go to azure.microsoft.com or azure.com, and you click on documentation. This is where you can find all the documentation to get started, the products and the architecture, reference architecture. So on the architecture center, this is where you will be able to find the virtual data center. So if you scroll down, you got different reference architecture for microservices, for data, for how to build for resiliency. And at the bottom, this is where you find the virtual data center. The virtual data center is the scaffold, and this is where we explain all the concepts. A good way to understand it is to start from a networking perspective, because we show you how to structure the network, how to group shared services, how to build a hub and spoke model that we took in this webinar. You can go to governance and review the guidance for single team or multiple team, depending how big is your company. For the large organization, we show the different way to implement it, from an identity management, role-based access, how to delegate the control. So have a read. And the next portal that is quite interesting is the Service Trust. The Service Trust, we show you some built-in reference architecture from a compliance perspective. So for example, if you want to build a PCI DSS reference architecture, let me just scroll down here. You will be able to see all the blueprint per group, per different frameworks. So you can have healthcare, government, and privacy. So PCI DSS is the one I was just referring to. You got some technical reference implementation ready to be deployed. So you can see how we've been implementing them, the controls, and you got all the documents listed all together.
All right, Laurent, thank you very much for this demo. Now, if we look a little bit back on this cloud adoption framework, we have something called Azure Scaffold or Azure Scaffolding that is really about putting all together the elements that you need to have into an environment when you go live. So at the very center of it, we see what we call the core, which is basically, well, the technical implementation of the virtual machine, the virtual network, and all those fundamental elements of a cloud infrastructure. And then to put all those elements together is putting about the identity and access management control, the rollback access model with the delegation of the roles and the duties, all the security layers, of course, all the ops aspects, monitoring and alerting. If something happening in terms of performance or in terms of security, you want to get notifications on that. The cost management is an important part of the governance, of course. And then all the automation and the templates via DevOps. So you have your Azure series of hierarchy and subscription hierarchy, and maybe customer have multiple subscriptions. So how do you put that together? Or how do you create and cement all subscription together? Because you have Azure policy, you have Azure resource manager policy and all those elements. So how do you put that together?
So let me talk about the management groups. So the management groups are designed to help you to deal with the growth in your implementation. So let's say, for example, you got more than one subscriptions in a dev, test, pre-prod, and production environment. So how do you enforce, Arnaud, that you've got consistency across all those different environments? And management groups has been designed for that. So is to you can create a hierarchy of different components to enforce that some rules will be applied regardless of the subscriptions that you are creating. So it's a very good way to be able to give enough control to the centralized IT team and so provide some delegation to the developers and to the business units.
So something that we are seeing on this slide here is this kind of management group where you put subscription in it?
Yeah. So you can have a hierarchy of management groups. Mm-hmm. So you can have the root at the very top. This is where you want to enforce, for example, your global security policy. So security will say, I want to enforce X, Y, Z. And then you may want to create a hierarchy because it won't be exactly the same for production versus for non-production. So you can adjust and apply different level of security.
So I think here one piece of advice that we can give people listening today is probably at the root, you're being very humble and very audit-based approach and only put the absolutely non-negotiable. You don't want to block something at the top root and then block everyone to do stuff because it can have unexpected impacts on other environment, because this is a hierarchical model, right?
Absolutely. And this is why you need to be able to practice. This is something you need to be able to practice to make sure that you are not blocking your production or even all your development your developers. So make sure that the design of the hierarchy help you also to practice and to learn before you roll out that everywhere.
Okay, good. So just to summarize, I would have like a top organization a management group. Then I will have different management group where I put different subscription. I can put, for instance, one management group for my, let's say, PCI DSS environment, where I put all the subscription that needs to have the specific audit compliance.
Correct.
This way we do it.
So there's different ways of doing it. So you can do it per business unit, you can do it per project, you can do it based on the criticality of the data, like the PCI DSS or the PI data, if you are dealing with sensitive information and want to protect from data leakage. So there's different ways you can organize it. But bear in mind, at the end, it's to enforce consistency. So what you want to apply here is to make sure apply to everybody.
So in a sense, a management group is a container where you put subscription and where you apply policies.
Policies. And what you can apply, it's the Azure policies. So the Azure policies are designed to, if I give you some example, to enforce something that you want to apply regardless if you are an administrator or not. So it's for everybody. So I want to avoid, for example, my developers to be able to put a public IP address. That's the common requirements that I'm here quite a lot. I don't want shadow IT. I don't want on Kubernetes cluster to deploy an application and make sure the developer won't be able to put a public IP address. So that's what you can enforce using an Azure policy. You can also detect if something has not been done against your policy. You can enforce an image gallery. So large organizations want to have their own image management and make sure that you cannot use the one from the marketplace. So that's this type of example you can play with the policy. So it may not be the same rules between a prod and non-prod and a dev. This is why you need the hierarchy.
Very nice. There's also this idea of remediation, which means that actually, you could block something wrong of happening at the beginning, but you could also, it's another strategy, let it happen and do automatic remediation.
Absolutely. So let's say, for example, you don't want to constrain too much the developer, you want also, because you need to make sure that everybody can learn on this journey. And that's something for me very important. Don't forget, don't use the governance and the compliance to constrain people and block the innovation. So if you want people to learn and to be able to deliver some value on Azure, let's say, for example, they deploy an image, but you don't have an antivirus. This is something bad. So you want to be able to detect that and automatically enforce the remediation. And that's what Azure Policy can do. They can detect if some extensions have not been installed, and you can report it and make a decision, or you can also force the installation.
Very nice. So let's have a look at a little bit of the architecture. A typical architecture blueprint that we see with customer now is actually the core of the Azure scaffolding framework that we see. And we see very, very much this type of adoption where you have at the very center what we call a hub virtual network, where you put all the shared services. Yep. And you put, let's say, all the network inspection devices, all the things that needs to be shared with all the services that you have in the cloud. And then you have different spoke virtual network that are paired with this center, with this topology in the center. So essentially, when you deploy a new workload in the cloud, you don't have to recreate and rethink about new layers of firewalling, new layers of policy, new layers of management of the environment. It's already there. So ultimately, allowing you to innovate faster.
Yeah.
So how does this comes back into the picture? And the picture of management group and policies. I think probably it's a good time for you to do a little bit of a demo on that.
Yeah, just before the demo. So what you see here is what we call a hub and spoke. So hub and spoke, in you can imagine in the hub and spoke, I may have different strategies. It is normal in a hub, for example, that you can put a firewall and a public DMZ. So you may want to put a public IP address, if I reuse my example that I was introducing earlier. And on the spoke, you don't want a public IP address. So what I'm going to do is take that example and show you how you can implement a management group hierarchy for hub and spoke topology.
Very nice.
Let me do that.
You can click on all services and you will find the management groups, or directly from the launcher, your favorites. So you can create management group hierarchy to group the different subscriptions. So you click on Add Management Group, and this is where you will create the different groups. Or you can link to an existing one if you want to build a hierarchy. So what I've done here so far, I've got a dev and a hub and spoke management groups. And you see below the spoke, I put my subscription. So let's go to the policy. And in the policy, in the overview, you can see the overall policies that are applied to your subscriptions. You can see here I'm 100% compliant. The get started is a good way to be able to start with policies. So let's view the definitions first. In the definitions, you can see that you got a built-in library of policies that are coming out of the box. And they are all open source, available on the GitHub, so they will grow over time. Some are in preview, some are not. You got categories as well, when you can filter the policies you want to review. You can also search for a custom policy. So I've got one created here called Deny Public IP Address. And if you explore the content of the policy, you can see the effect is a denied. And here I've got the different rules. So I don't want to be able to apply a public IP to an existing NIC, and I don't want to put a new public IP. So let's see how we can assign the policy. So when you go to the assign policy, you can assign the policy either to the management groups or directly to a resource group in your subscription. Because we want to drive policy and leveraging management group, the best way is to apply it to the spoke. So I click on the spoke. And now I'm saying this policy will be assigned to the spoke. You can also use the initiative, which is a set of policies that you can apply to a resource. So for example, here you got the OMS extension. So you want to monitor a virtual machine or a virtual machine scale set. So you can Yeah, you can explore, for example, the monitoring of the VM scale set, and you can see you got different sets of policies that you want to evaluate. So some of them can be deployed if they does not exist, or you can just decide to trigger an audit to inform that this extension has not been installed. So you got exactly the same approach. So it's a JSON definition when you define all the criteria. So here you got the image. And if it is not, the deployment is not done, then you can include the ARM template deployment with all the parameters to add the extension to the virtual machine. So if I scroll down, you will see all the parameters.
So thank you very much, Laurent, for this demo with all the native tools, the portal. Of course, you can do that with CLI and with PowerShell as well, and ARM template. But if you want to do that outside of the Microsoft tooling, I think you have quite a lot of options. Yeah.
So we got some great third-party tools. HashiCorp is an example. It's not the only example, so we got plenty of ways to do it. As you know, on Azure, you can do it with the Microsoft native tools. You can use open source technology or third-party toolings. So HashiCorp has a very interesting tools for Azure automation, because when you deploy the virtual data center and all those layers that we just described earlier, you will notice that not always it is just Azure resources that you have to put in place, but if you have to put a checkpoint firewall, you have to configure. So HashiCorp is very good to wire up all those different components all together. So I use it a lot to build security and compliance and build a virtual data center. And if you want, I can show you a demo.
Let's go for that.
So what you see here is different Terraform scripts. So this is an example or to create the resource groups. And this is the management groups that we saw earlier, the dev environment policy and the hub and spoke. And this is very simple with Terraform to group objects together. You can see the parent management group ID, and this is the policy. So the policy describes my custom policy. So I can put that in a declarative language, put all my controls, and I can put that in my source control as well. So the scope here is apply that policy just to resource group, which is the resource group spoke number one. So we expect spoke number one to have the policy applied. So the way Terraform is working, you have to initialize it, and then you have to do a Terraform plan. Terraform plan is tell me what has been deployed and what are the gaps between what I describe here and what is already deployed. So you see there's a data that are being evaluated with different states, and Terraform will tell me everything is all good, no change, your infrastructure is up to date. So if I go to the portal, you can see indeed my two resource groups, so spoke number one, and I should be able to see my policy. And bingo, you can see deny IP address is applied and it's compliant because there's no public IP address. So spoke number two should not have the policy. And that's indeed the case, right? So we got the desired state in place. So now let's go to the portal and see what's happening if someone tried to use the portal, so not Terraform, to create a public IP address. So let's select the public IP address, click on create. I'm going to give it a name, so pip for public IP address. Yeah, pip one, and I'm going to select the resource group. So if I want to create in resource group number one, regardless of the location, and I click on create, I should have a deny. And you can see here on the validation step, I've got an error, and the error is explicit. It's been denied because of the policy. But what's happening if I'm trying to create the same public IP address on the spoke number two? The validation is successful because I don't have a public, I don't have a policy applied to the spoke number two, so I'm able to create the public IP address. So one of the scenarios that we see in the organization, so sometimes policy evolve over time and you may want to apply new policies and you want to be able to track what are the components that are not compliant. So let's say in that case, I want now to apply my policy to this resource group. And I want the policy to be able to report what are the components that are not compliant through the policy. So I'm going to pick up my custom policy created with Terraform, click on select, assign. And now my policy has been assigned. So you have to wait a little bit for the policy engine to evaluate if you are compliant or not. So when you click on it, you can see it is red, not started. But after a period of time, couple of minutes, you will see the policy will be evaluated. And if I come back to my policy, so now you can see 75% of compliance. And I can see indeed, this one is marked non-compliant. I click on it, and I'm able to see the component that is impacted. So that's my public IP address. So that has been flagged. So you can connect that to your alerting. So we'll talk about in a future module about monitoring and alerting. But that's how you can be notified that you've got a non-compliant component. So you can do it in an audit mode at the beginning to report the non-compliance. That's a good way to start. And then you can enforce people to remove it. So in that case, if I remove the policy, you will see that the policy engine is going to be re-evaluated. And after a period of time, everything will come back to green. It's a good way to help and educate the architects and developers.
All right, Laurent, thank you very much for this very comprehensive demo. Another or way that we have to cement all of those things together is with a new concept of Azure called Azure Blueprint. So Azure Blueprint, in a sense, is a way to put together all the elements of a deployment. So an RBAC model, a set of policy definition, and the IRM template by itself, which deploys the resources like the VM, compute, network storage, etc. And it's a way to basically tie all of this together and drive the deployment of a certain amount of workloads in a controlled fashion. So it's not like you can deploy the IRM template and whatever is the admin model. You have this IRM template and mandatory, you would have the set of policy that will apply, and you will have this set of RBAC model that will be applying with things that you can see from the beginning, from your template definition. You can mandate that this security group would be, for instance, administrator or contributor to a specific resource group, or it can be something that you provision at the time where you instantiate the resource under the blueprint, right?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And it's a very good way to link that to what I show you at the beginning also with the Azure architecture and all the reference architecture. Because most of the time, the business will come or the developer will come and say, oh, I want to start this project, I need a new subscription, so how do you start with that? And this is where in the hub and spoke and those architecture, you want to have this predefined approved reference architecture that you want to deploy in an empty subscription. So how do you link that to the network? How do you make sure that security will be able to get access to all the activities? Make sure that the developers are not doing something that has not been authorized. Yeah. So that's how the blueprint will be able to automate the creation of all the foundation of the services that you've got in this subscription. But the beauty of it, you can then delegate the subscription to the developers. They can be owner of the subscription, but they cannot touch what has been deployed by the blueprint.
Very nice. So since this session is about making it real,
let me show you.
Let's go for another demo.
Absolutely.
It is a service where we can group together all the policies and the management group that we've seen earlier. So it's a good way to drive policies. So let's take an example. So I'm going to create a Kubernetes blueprint for my developers. So they want to deploy Kubernetes for an internal project. So I'm going to deploy that on the spokes. And in my blueprint, you can see I can group different artifacts. So at the top level, I can put policy assignment, role, some template or resource group. Let me create a resource group. So this resource group will be where my resources will be deployed. So I'm going to name it K8S for Kubernetes. And that will be my resource group. You can also define the name of the resource group at deployment and the location as well, or you can force it at the definition. So let me go in my resource group. And in my resource group, I want to add additional artifacts. So the one will be a role assignment, but I can also use the ARM template to be able to deploy my Kubernetes cluster. So let me put the role. I want to give my developer a contributor role, but you can also give them a reader role. And then you can map it to an Azure Active Directory group. So this is my project. So if you add the user to this security group, automatically the user will have access to my blueprint. I click on add, and I'm going to save a draft. So you can add much more in the blueprint, but for the purpose of this demo, let's save the draft as is. So now I've got a draft, and the next step is to publish my blueprint. I'm going to publish that blueprint and give it a version. So let's start with the 0.1, and I'm going to name it initial version. So now my blueprint has been published. The next step is to assign my blueprint. So think about the management group that we created earlier. So I want to assign this blueprint to the subscription linked to my Spoke resource group and Spoke management group. And this is for my subscription. So let's select it. Can define a location and pick up the versioning. I can also apply a lock. The lock is very good. So think about deploying, so scaffolding your subscription with some reference architecture. You want to make sure that the owners cannot change it. The lock will prevent that. So then put the resource group name. So that will be the name of my project. So project one. And I can also define the location. Where do you want this project to be executed? So it will be more in Southeast Asia. So I'm creating my resources in Southeast Asia, and I will get my Kubernetes cluster. So now the blueprint is going to scaffold my subscription. And if you click on Assign Blueprint, you can see that it is in waiting mode. So you click on it, and now it's going to deploy the resources. So you can see the resource group has been created. Now it's assigning the permissions and applying the lock, as you can see in the information. Now my blueprint has been deployed. Let's have a look and see my resource group. You can see this resource group has been created automatically by the blueprint. It's empty, but if I click on access control, let's see who has access. So click on role assignment. And you should be able to see in the contributor the Azure Active Directory group, which is the case. And on the deny, you can see that all the other principals have been denied access. So meaning that even if you give an ownership of that the subscription, they won't be able to touch the blueprint resources.
Very nice. Thank you, Laurent, for this demo. Very good. Just to recap the things that we have seen so far, so the things to put it together, management group, to put all your subscription together in a logical view, policies to be applied on those management group to constrain what can be done and automatically remediate on the compliance of an environment, and having a nice reporting dashboard of the compliance of an environment, and the way to manage the deployment in always predictable, standardized deployment, so the resources with their policy, their RBAC mode, is called Azure Blueprint.
Correct.
All of that, of course, relying on Azure Resource Manager environment and enforced at the ARM layer. So whichever way you enact, you act with this portal, the ARM CLI, PowerShell, or third-party tools, it's all transparent and using this environment. So if we summary now and we take a little bit of a step back, we talk about governance of an environment, and that's really the very foundational aspect of getting to the cloud, but it's of course just the beginning, right? So it's as important, and it comes as a very good foundation to build on and work on the deployment of security technology, work on the resiliency of the environment, and very importantly, well, all the ops part of it.
Yeah, and maybe one feedback from what I've learned as well in all my experience working with large organizations, it's a shared responsibility model. So sometimes there's a myth that if I deploy on Azure, everything will be compliant, everything will be secure, everything will be automated. You have to do your part as well. So we give you a platform with a set of services, but with all those governance and toolings and security and automation and managing high availability, you have to do your part as well. You have to engineer your architecture to make sure that you will get the benefit of the Azure platform.
Absolutely. So we already talked in many Indo sessions previously about the security and resiliency aspect. One of the very next sessions that you can expect from us is around all the ops side. So all the monitoring, Azure Monitor, Log Analytics, how do you put that together and come as a natural extension of your governance environment? Well, stay tuned. This is for another session. If you want to go deeper onto that topic. I think there's a very good session that was done by colleagues in Microsoft Ignite event a couple of weeks ago. So that's on my Ignite. You will get the link in the slides of the session, of course. And they explain actually how BP did the design of their environment. They built a cloud environment and everything built on those policies and dynamic infrastructure and all the infrastructure as code layer. Laurent, thank you very much for being here today and explaining us all of that.
Thank you, Arnaud. It was a pleasure.
It was very short pleasure, and see you soon on the APAC Azure Infrastructure Webinar Series.
Thank you.